Good morning.
Good morning.
So indeed a pleasure for me to be here with you this morning, but I almost said no when I found out that last year you had a wounded veteran and a dog. And you know, so the wounded veteran, that's the epitome of selfless service, and the dog, well, that's the epitome of loyalty and probably cuteness. And so I really thought, had to think long and hard. But when Chuck told me that he was interested in having me come and talk to you about this kind of near and dear to my heart and some of my favorite subjects, so I said yes. And again, coming to Florida in January, I thought, well, what a great opportunity to work on my tan or to warm up a little bit, but not happening today. All right, leadership, discipline, and teamwork. These things work together, and over the course of the next few minutes, I hope you'll see this the same way I see it, or at least maybe at some point at the break, we can have a discussion about it if you see it a little bit differently. Like Chuck said, I graduated from the Military Academy in 83 and spent 23 years on active duty. In that time, I commanded paratroopers at the platoon, the company, and battalion level. Spent about 3 years in combat on active duty and a little under a year as a civilian. Since that time, I've had the opportunity to work with businesses, with government agencies, and with a professional baseball team. And I've seen that there's some similarities and there's some things that connect. And I hope that I'll get a chance to show you some of that as well. But you know, the military example, the sports analogies, we throw those out there all the time. Sports is like combat. Soldiers want to be like athletes. Athletes want to be like soldiers. I think business people can learn a lot the same way. Any veterans in the crowd here first? Let me ask you that. Okay, thank you for your service. And yes, I wrote a book, Leadership and Balance. I'll talk about that a little bit because that's my perspective on leadership. First thing I want to talk about is the difference between leader and leadership. They're not the same thing. We throw that out there all the time. When we talk about leadership, what we're really talking about is the leader. And when we talk about the leader, what we really talk about sometimes is leadership. So let's talk about the difference. First thing is, the leader is a noun. Leader is a position, right? That's a person, place, or thing. If you're a director, a supervisor, a shift lead, a foreman, right? That's a position. That's a position you've been put in and you've been designated as the leader. As a leader, you're responsible for accountability. What's accountability? Accountability is something that someone else, the organization, the team you lead, it's something they demand of you. Your revenue, your safety standards, the quality standards. As the leader, you're held accountable for those things. How is leadership different? Well, leadership's different first and foremost because it's a verb, right? It's an action. And if it's an action, it means anybody can do it. It's not left to just that person who's the official leader. And oh, by the way, there are informal leaders as well, right? You know it, in every group, there's that designated leader, but then there's also those informal leaders. That guy or gal that everybody looks to, you know, when the word comes down, when this new directive comes down, that's the first person everybody looks to go, okay, how's Chuck gonna respond to this? I'm gonna follow his lead, right? So you've got to be aware of that. They're both formal and informal, but when you're talking about leadership, anybody can do it. So it's how do you show up every day? It's about presence. And then finally, leadership, different from being the leader, is not about accountability, it's about ownership. What's ownership? Ownership is the things you demand of yourself. It's not what anybody else demands of you, it's what you demand of yourself. So that's the difference between leader and leadership. My perspective on leadership is leadership and balance and something I call a fulcrum-centric leadership. Now, y'all, this graphic is a little bit different. This is meant to be a seesaw. Right? So in mechanics, simple mechanics, this is a type 1 lever. This is the lever here. This is the fulcrum. The fulcrum is the thing that balances and gives leverage to these two weights, these two things different out here, right? So my model of leadership has three parts to it. First part is self-awareness. you have to know your natural tendency, not as a leader, but as in leadership, right? And I think there are four essential domains of leadership. Self-awareness is the key. What does that mean? Self-awareness, your tendency. That's your default position. Each and every one of us has a bias, a natural tendency in each of these four domains. If you don't know what that is, you're kind of out there blind, right? So you want to figure out what that is, and I have developed a survey that will help you see what your natural tendency is. That's step one. Step two, it's what we call situational awareness. Situational awareness is knowing what's going on in the environment around you, what's going on with your team members, as individuals and collectively as a unit. So know yourself, know your team and the environment you're operating in and what it demands of you. And then finally, when you see something that's not quite right, an imbalance, there's too much weight on one side or the other, be the fulcrum. Be that point upon which everything else finds balance. How does that work? Okay, four essential domains of leadership. Again, leadership, anybody can do this. This is how you show up. Communications, adaptability, focus, and influence. Now, each one of these domains has got an opposite end. That makes eight tendencies. These opposite ends are what I call the exclusive tendencies and the inclusive tendencies. What's exclusive? Exclusive means you're not taking in any input from the outside. It's a closed system. You're not listening, you're not taking advice. I mean, in the extreme case, you're on your own. And inclusive is a totally open system. You're taking in all the inputs you can get. You're receiving, you're making judgments based on what you're hearing from the outside environment. So communications, that looks like this. The extreme exclusive domain or tendency in this domain is transmit. You've seen that. That's somebody that all they do is talk. They never listen. So receive is the opposite tendency in this domain, right? And again, we're talking about extremes. Most of us are going to be somewhere in between there in our natural tendency. Adaptability I mark as rigid and flexible. Now, in this one, you know, you can look at all of these exclusive tendencies and go, oh, that's negative. I don't want to be in the exclusive. I want to be in the inclusive. But my point in all of this is that there are situations that demand of all of us to sometimes be the thing that we're not naturally inclined to be. Take adaptability, for instance. You just saw these safety videos, right? Certainly, in your line of work, there are safety standards that you absolutely cannot be flexible on. You've got to be totally rigid about them because lives are at stake. Millions of dollars are at stake. Your livelihood, your job, your whole position in the community is at stake if you allow somebody to do something that is unsafe, or if you yourself become flexible in your safety standards. Can't do it. Quality's probably another one. You got to be rigid. But something like, Chuck, what were you calling it? Your voice picking, right? Somebody probably came up with an idea of how we could be more efficient, and it was a process that didn't demand a rigid standard, so you're allowed to be more flexible, and you're going to give it a try here in February. Focus. This is the one I think, certainly for me anyway, I think people will find the hardest getting their head around. Because you look at these extreme tendencies, exclusive and inclusive. Exclusive is selfish, and inclusive is selfless, right? So you're either thinking about yourself and nothing else, or you're thinking about everything but yourself on these opposite tendencies. And anybody in this room is going to go, well, I certainly wouldn't ever admit to being selfish. I mean, 20 plus years in the military, I can tell you that selfless service is the hallmark of, it's one of the seven leadership, or one of the seven core values of the Army. But I'll also tell you that there are situations you'll find yourself in where you have to put, let's call it, your self-interest ahead of something else. It might be something related to your family. You've got to take a different job, or you've got to do something, ask for time off on the weekend. Here's a perfect example, right? To show you that this does happen in life. Anybody ever fly on an airplane? Right? Before you take off, what's the thing they do first? The safety briefing, right? tell you how to put on your seatbelt. They talk about those little yellow cups that are going to fall from the ceiling. And what do they tell you? If you're traveling with somebody, an infant or somebody who's, you know, sick or can't do this on their own, put your mask on first before you put on theirs. Now, trust me, that's a selfish act. You're taking care of yourself first, but there's a reason for it, right? In that moment, it's a selfish act. But in the long term, when you look at it, you're saving yourself, so now you're in a position to save other people. So there's a little bit of judging there, or a little bit of maybe rationality to it, but it is in fact a selfish act, and there's a reason for it. All right, influence. This one is at the level most of us operate at, you know, I mean, the CEO of your company talking about your 2020 mission statement, that's strategic and that's vision, right? But for most of us, we're at the tactical level, and the heart of leadership is influence. It's how do you get other people to do things, right? And I use command and control here as the extreme markers. Control is a very direct style. You tell people exactly what to do. You tell people how to do it. Whereas in command, it's an indirect influence, and it's about, again, going back to presence and getting people to do something in a way that's an indirect influence. I put them in this order because communications is the first thing we have to talk about. It's fundamental to the other three, but it's also fundamental to that second step in my program, which is situational awareness. If you're not telling people the kinds of things you need to know and transmitting when it's appropriate, you're not going to know what's going on in the situation. If you're not open to receiving the information you need to know as a leader or showing leadership within your team, you're not going to get there. And then finally, influence, that's the first among equals, because ultimately it's about getting something done, reaching our revenue objectives, reaching our quality objectives, reaching our safety objectives. You get there through influence. And in my book, I Be the Fulcrum, I use the term your inner fat kid, right? Because you're going to throw it out of balance if you let your natural tendency go with what you're doing. You've got to. If you're on the playground and you see two kids at different weight, they can't ride the seesaw if they're both sitting on the seats at the end, right? But they can if the heavier kid moves in to the center. Now, you're not going to move this fulcrum, right? It's stuck in the ground. So that's the only way you get balance. And I could have said, be the thing on the lever that moves in towards the fulcrum or wherever you have to go to find balance, and that would have been too wordy and hard to remember. So I settle on be the fulcrum as the thing I want people to remember. And when you show up with leadership in the organization where you work, be the thing upon which you find balance and that makes it work. All right, enough about domains and leadership. Let me tell you about an example of leadership. This guy, Bill McCraven, you may have heard of him, you may have seen him. He was the commander of the Joint Special Operations Command. He was a Navy SEAL for 37 years, 3-star Admiral, commander of JSOC, and 4-star commander of U.S. Special Operations Command in Tampa, right down the road here. He was a 1-star Admiral when I worked for him at the Joint Special Operations Command, and he's currently the Chancellor of the University of Texas System. I can tell you of all the people I worked with or worked for in the military, and it pains me to say this as an Army guy, but this Navy guy was probably the most balanced leader, certainly one of the top five balanced leaders I've ever worked for. He gave a graduation address at the University of Texas Austin in 2014, just before he retired. And the title of his speech was 10 Life Lessons, or 10 Lessons I Learned About Life from Navy SEAL Training. And he begins each one of these lessons talking about, if you want to change the world, make your bed first thing in the morning. If you want to change the world, judge people by their character, not by the size of their swim flippers, right? That's a favorite of mine, right? Judge people not by their size, but by their character. If you want to change the world, at the darkest moment, be your best. He talks about having to go under a ship, and it's very dark, and place an explosive device on the keel of the ship as part of their training. And if you want to change the world, never quit. Those are my four favorite of the 10 he talks about. And while it's a commencement address and he's talking to young graduates who are about to enter the real world, so he's telling them if you want to change the world, it's really it's a briefing about leadership. And I would recommend you go on YouTube, you Google his name, University of Texas Austin graduation, you watch it. It's about 20 minutes long and you'll be inspired. So now we move on to discipline. Why is discipline important? Chuck and I, when we were at school as freshmen, we had to memorize this briefing verbatim. It starts out, "The discipline which makes the soldiers of a free country reliable in battle." The discipline which makes the soldiers of a free country reliable in battle is not to be gained by harsh or tyrannical treatment. Now, he starts off there. This is John Schofield, and he's addressing the Corps of Cadets in 1879, and he's talking about toxic leadership. You can't be a jerk and get people to follow you. And he goes on and he talks about respect. If you want to get people to respect you as a leader, then you have to respect them first. And so this is a critical point, I think, for leadership. And if you've read anything lately or seen anything lately about millennials, right, the which are about to be the majority of the workforce, that they're all about purpose and respect. Well, he said this in 1879. So I'm telling you, it's not anything brand new. It's been the way it's always been. More to it, discipline, a definition of discipline might be this. Discipline is doing the right thing at the right time for the right reason when no one's watching. Right? When people are watching you, it's real easy to do the right thing because, well, you know, people are watching. But if no one's watching, what are you going to do? That's the heart and soul of discipline. But let me tell you this. My experience has been that there's hardly ever a time when no one's watching, especially if you're the leader. Someone is always watching. Maybe not your actions, but they're going to see the effects of your action. Here's another reason why discipline matters. Discipline matters because it works with these two things, trust and loyalty, right? So trust and loyalty, and this is a cycle. Trust, what is trust? Trust is both the glue that holds everything together, holds the team together, but it's also the grease that keeps things moving. If we can't trust each other, we're not going to get anything done, and we're not going to stay together as a team. That's a fact. And loyalty is important because it's a matter of believing in something bigger than yourself, right? Not different from that domain of leadership I talked about where it's your focus. This is about believing in something bigger than yourself, and that's team all the way across the board. So discipline is facilitated by trust and loyalty. If I know you trust me, I'm going to do the right thing. If I know you've got my back, you're loyal to me, I'm going to do the right thing. It makes it easier for me. And if I'm doing the right thing, I'm going to build the trust and loyalty not only in me, but in the organization and the team as we work together. All right, so an example. You guys picked a great example for discipline. There is probably in the history of warfare no group of soldiers that were more disciplined than the Spartans. Thermopylae, right? This is the movie 300 is about this battle at Thermopylae. It happened in 480 BC, right? About a long time ago, right? So Thermopylae, it means the hot gates. So it was this very restrictive piece of terrain, all right? And there were 300 Spartans, but there were about 7,000 Greek soldiers there from all the different city-states. But they were up against, best estimate, probably the most realistic estimate, over 100,000 Persians. Pretty stiff odds, right? As you saw in the movie clips, they had a culture of discipline, and they had this saying when you went off to battle. Come home with your shield, carrying it, or on it, being carried by your shield, right? If you can't come home carrying your shield, you better be wounded or dead. And you saw in the movie clip there, just as the battle's about to go, King Leonidas say, come and get them. The Greek for that is Mulan Labe. You know, the Persian said, give up your weapons. And his response was, come and take them. Now that's discipline, right? They were sent there to slow down or stop the Persian army so the rest of the Greek forces could gather and fight. Now, what makes the 300 important is, as you know from the movie here, and you've seen the movie, they're betrayed. They fought for 2 days. And at the end of the battle on 2 days, the second day, they were betrayed by a local who showed them a path around to the rear area. And when King Leonidas figured this out, he said, okay, all the rest of you got to get out of here. and go back to fight. But the 300 and another 1,000 or so Greeks stayed behind to let them escape and go on and fight to another day. They died to a man. That's discipline, doing the right thing for the right reason. It's given up a lot. So Afghanistan, let me give you another example. Now, you might, those of you who know your history know, well, the Spartans never fought in Afghanistan. Well, I'm not talking about Leonidas and those Spartans. I'm talking about modern-day Spartans. Can you see that picture in the back? All right, that guy right there, his name is Chuck Ritter. I first met him in 2013 when we were both at a place in Afghanistan called Camp Moorhead. And he was working with a commando battalion of Afghan commandos, kind of like our Army Rangers. And I was helping to build their headquarters, the Special Operations Headquarters for the Afghan Army. Became friends. We left at about the same time in June of 2013. I went out walking. He went out on a stretcher because he'd been shot in a firefight, rescuing an Afghan commando who had been pinned down in the street. No one else would go, so Chuck went. Even though he was a senior position within his team, he was a team sergeant. And he was shot dragging this guy back in. That was his second Purple Heart. This picture is from 2014, and that's his third Purple Heart. What happened? So Chuck's leading, well, he's part of a team. You know, there's 12 people in a Special Forces Operational Detachment Alpha. He's the senior non-commissioned officer, so basically second in charge. And they have this mission to go rescue these Afghan forces that were off in a place called Kunduz, and they were surrounded and about to lose, right? So he flies in helicopters with his team and about 30 Afghan commandos. And they get put down in the wrong spot. So as soon as he comes off the helicopter, he takes a machine gun round to his hand, his right hand. He's right-handed, right? So what's he do? He keeps going. He shifts his weapon to his left hand, and he gets to cover ultimately, and he grabs the Air Force guy with him, and he starts calling in close air support. F-16, AC-130 gunships, Apache helicopters, and they get the Taliban to break, and they link up with the commandos they went in to rescue, and it took over 8 hours. And in that 8 hours, Chuck refused medical attention other than to have his hand wrapped, and he refused pain medication because he knew he needed a clear head. And why did he do that? Well, okay, he knew people were watching, everybody was watching, his team, all the commandos. But his discipline in that day built greater trust and loyalty in his team. It got the mission accomplished. And so he's an example, in my mind, of a modern-day Spartan. I don't know if you can see it or not, but there's kind of a pool of blood right here coming off of his hand. That actually turned out to be probably the worst of the three Purple Hearts, the one that's caused him the most surgeries. He just got picked up to be a command sergeant major, which is the highest level non-commissioned officer rank in the Army. Great guy. All right, teamwork. Teamwork. What are the essential elements of teamwork? We know from looking at elite teams across the board that there are some critical and essential elements that all teams share. The first one is purpose. You got to have some reason for doing what you're doing. That's the why. Right, we're all driven by some why. We have our personal why, we have the big why, we got the little why. Why am I doing this task today, right? But we're talking about teamwork, so it's more than just a purpose, it's a shared purpose. We all have to believe in the same thing, the same reason for doing this. A drive to succeed. Now, if you didn't want to win, you know, why are you doing it? If you didn't want to be the best, why would you bother being on a team, right? You could sit home watching reruns of some TV show, right? Or you could go off and do something and just be mediocre. But if you really want to be a part of a team with a purpose, a shared purpose, you're driven to succeed. We know that elite organizations are learning organizations. They're constantly trying to improve. In the Army, we have this thing called the after-action review, and that's that part of that production cycle where you stop after every event as soon as you can, and you talk about, okay, what was the plan? What did we actually do? Where was there a difference? What did we do well? What could we do better next time? And you learn and you grow. There's a great book called Mindset, written by Carol Dweck. She's a professor at Stanford University. And she talks about a growth mindset versus a fixed mindset. And how do you learn and you grow by saying things like, okay, I didn't do my best, or I didn't accomplish this task. I'm not there yet, but I'll get there if I keep working at it and I learn and I grow. And then finally, the fourth thing I think that's common to all elite teams is this idea of grit, right? You're never going to quit. McRaven talks about it in his graduation address. This is a fundamental and essential element of teams that succeed, right? Together, you're not going to quit. And a great book about that is Grit by a gal named Angela Duckworth, who's a professor at the University of Pennsylvania. So those are the essential elements of teamwork, right? Well, what does that look like in the real world? Okay, so coordination, synchronization, and synergistic effects. Big words that mean what? Well, coordination, that's what happened here today, right? Somebody coordinated this building, these chairs, the AV system, right? So that's bringing together assets. You do that every day. But what you really want to do to get good is you want to synchronize. Synchronization is when you bring together the effects of those assets, right? That's when you bring an engaged audience, a dynamic speaker, a great leader, all those things together. That's going to give you an effect, right? And we call that a synergistic effect. What does that mean? Synergistic effect means that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. 1 + 1 = 3. Now, okay, I wasn't great at math, and I know, you know. No, synergistic effect, 1 + 1 = 3, or maybe it equals 5, right? Because it's greater than those separate things together just by adding them up. Love this quotation. The strength of the pack is the wolf, and the strength of the wolf is the pack. Now, often when we talk about a team and the strength, the analogy we use is the chain. You all heard that, right? Right, a team is like a chain, and it's only as strong as its weakest link. That's true. You know, but it's negative. I like this because it focuses on the positive, right? Every wolf in the pack is different, but they've got strengths, and together they're even stronger. Do y'all know who said this? You got kids, seen Disney movies, The Jungle Book. A guy by the name of Rudyard Kipling, who wrote a lot of great stories about soldiers and fighting, but he also wrote The Jungle Book. Now, Phil, basketball fans in here? Chicago Bull fans? Yeah, so when Phil Jackson was, yes, no? Okay, sorry. Orlando Magic, is that who we're rooting for here? So when Phil Jackson was the head coach of the Chicago Bulls, he used this quotation extensively to fire up Michael Jordan and some other guys on that team, and they won 6 championships. So, you know, probably a better way of looking at team and strength versus that weak link in the chain, even though it's true. Teamwork examples. You know who these guys are? Yeah, it's rugby. It's the New Zealand All Blacks, right? New Zealand All Blacks. New Zealand All Blacks are the most successful sports franchise in the last 100 years of sports. Their winning percentage is an amazing 84%. 84. Put that into context, right? The New York Yankees, over about the same period of time, have a 54% win rate, right? The Los Angeles Lakers, 60. Boston Celtics, 59. Pittsburgh Steelers, 52. 84% win rate. How do they do that? They're 3-time World Cup champions. The first time anybody's ever done this, won back-to-back, they did it with the 2011 and the 2015 World Cups. They have a culture of success and a culture of team. And a great book, if you want to read it, is called Legacy by James Kerr. He outlines 15 lessons you can learn from the All Blacks. One of the lessons is sweep the sheds. And his point there is that nobody in the organization, nobody on the team is so important that they can't take part in doing the small things that need to be done to keep the team going. So the team captain and the senior players take their turn cleaning up the locker room after games. Another one is go for the gap. When you're at the top of your game, look for the gap, look for the opening. Don't be complacent or satisfied with being the best. There's always room to grow. Go for that gap. Go for the bigger win. Another one is leave the jersey in a better place, right? The jersey is the symbol of the team. And I might be wearing it today, but tomorrow somebody else is going to be wearing it. And so I want to leave a legacy that can make the future New Zealand All Blacks proud of what I did. Now you can take that in your own organization, right? So are you here doing what you do because you just want to trade a time card for a paycheck? Or do you want to leave a legacy? Do you want to be part of something great? If you do, then you'll agree with the All Blacks and you'll look to legacy. And in 20, 30, 50 years from now, people may not remember your name, but they'll remember what you did here. Cohort 3, a little bit closer to home for me. Cohort 3 was a program the Army did in the 80s. It stands for Cohesion and Readiness Training. And what they did was they brought together teams from day one and kept them together for the life cycle of their enlistment, generally 3 years. I was privileged to have as the first platoon and company that I was ever a part of, this company here, Cohort 3. It was a part of the 82nd Airborne Division. The 82nd is known as the All-Americans because we pulled in people from World War I. They had members from every state, but it's still today. The 82nd pulls in people from all over the United States, all walks of life, city kids, country kids, and it's an amazing organization because the people who are in the 82nd volunteered twice. They volunteered the first time to join the Army, and then they volunteered to throw their butts out of airplanes. And my experience with this cohort company was pretty amazing. For me, it was a great growth experience. This picture, these are four of the men that were in my platoon. 1985, 86, anybody know where they're at? Some of you folks, what's that? They're in Berlin. They're standing in what was then West Berlin. Behind them is the Brandenburg Gate. And behind that is East Berlin and the Warsaw Pact and the Soviets. All right, so their purpose as a team was to prepare for, to jump, fight, and win, to jump in behind enemy lines at night and go kill something. At this point in time, these guys are probably average age 20, right? And that's what we expected them to do. That was their purpose. That's what they had to do as a team. Now, if you know anything about military operations, you know that in the best of times, they generally turn into something very chaotic and uncertain. We say that no plan ever survives first contact with the enemy. Well, if you're a paratrooper, you know that you don't even get that luxury. You start out in confusion and ambiguity because A, the Air Force is putting you out there on the drop zone and they never get you in the right spot. Never. So you start off in the wrong place at night, spread out all over the place. What do? Well, what you do is this thing we called LGOPs, little groups of paratroopers. Might be these four guys. They find each other in the drop zone, and they've already established what's minimum force. What do we need to go do our job? Not do we have to have everybody together, but what's the minimum thing we need? Usually it's a machine gun. This guy right here, Mike Kelly, he was one of my machine gunners. Bud O'Hare, he's a team leader. These two guys, Val Valenzano, Chuck Keller, AKA Q-Tip, they were riflemen. Get a radio and these four guys, the fifth guy, radio man, they go off and do anything, right? Because that's the way they trained and they believed in each other. Now I think the proof in that is that 20 years old then, pushing 50 now not the same four guys. Kelly's the only guy in this picture, right? They still get together. They have reunions. This is the Northeast chapter of 2nd Platoon. They created a legacy, you know, so that they, at 50, they still come together and they still appreciate each other's service. I was fortunate because, excuse me, in this picture, they're holding two things near and dear to my heart, my book and an award I created for the platoon back then. It's a pair of coconuts on a chain. We called it the fuzzy nuts. And hope I don't offend anybody there. But anyway, it was. I can tell you some stories about the fuzzy nuts and what these guys did to earn and hold and treasure them. I didn't know until a year or so later, after we first started this, that they were jumping it in on every airborne operation we ever did. The guy who had the fuzzy nuts would carefully pack it in his rucksack and jump it in. So anyway, it was a great group of guys. It was my pleasure and honor to be a part of something that continues on as a legacy. All right, conclusion, what do we mean? What's the important takeaways here? The important takeaway is, as you go forward into this new year, 2017, and you work towards your mission 2020, right? In a volatile and uncertain world, and anybody who doesn't think that we're currently in a very volatile and uncertain world hasn't been paying attention. Doesn't matter if you're talking politics, security, business, stuff out there is changing rapidly, for good and for bad, right? So you've got to be on your game, and it's teamwork grounded in discipline and leadership that will carry the day, no matter how challenging the situation. Whether you're the official leader or not, you got to show up. You've got to exercise leadership, you got to help create that balance, and you got to be the fulcrum. You got to do the right thing for the right reason. You have to find your shared purpose, work together as a team, and always learn and never quit. Do those things, you'll accomplish any task. If you want to learn more, again, I talked about some of these things. Bill McCraven's graduation address, Carol Dweck's book, Angela Duckworth's book, Stephen Pressfield. Stephen Pressfield wrote a book called Gates of Fire. The movie's based on a comic book. If you really want to know what happened, read Stephen Pressfield's Gates of Fire. Legacy by James Kerr, and then some book called Leadership and Balance by that guy. Do we have time for questions, or do you want to just... That either means I did a great job or a terrible job. Thank you for your time.
I got one.
Okay.
How many times you jumped up in
airplane? 132. That's why I'm this tall. Actually, it's because I'm this side that I probably walked away from 132 jumps. Big guys don't fare so well. They fall faster. Yeah.
And they land harder.
And they land harder. Sorry? I've got a lot of books I could recommend. Absolutely, sure. Some did, the better ones did. But I had some bad ones who didn't. I would say in general, the worst leaders I ever worked for were all on that far end exclusive. In all four domains, they were exclusive. They were transmit, they were rigid, they were selfish, even though they spoke a good game about selflessness. And they were very controlling. But that's not necessarily what made them the worst leaders. What made them the worst leaders was they were those things, and they could never recognize it and be the fulcrum and shift. And so the best leaders I ever had were generally more on the inclusive side. But when they had to, they could tell you, hey, no, this is the way you're going to do it, son. Why? Because they knew better, right? But they would also take the time to communicate that with me, the really good ones. Yeah, communications is absolutely central. Now, the first part of that question you asked me was I the kind of guy to just, you know, do whatever, or would I push back? So when Chuck introduced me, he introduced me as retired lieutenant colonel. Yeah, so if you know about rank structure, that's far from the top. Had if that's not an indication of whether or not I pushed back, that I retired as a lieutenant colonel instead of a general, I don't know of a better one, but that's probably a pretty good indication that at times I was kind of a more of a pushback kind of a guy. So,
if you would, can you send this whole paraphrase to you?
He's going to keep it. He'll download it and have it available to you. So absolutely.
Appreciate
it. No, my pleasure. Yes.
How many bodies you got?
How many what?
How many bodies?
How many? I got one body. It's right here. It's this one. And that's about as far as I'm going to take that question. But thanks for asking.
Hey, guys. I thought it was a pretty relevant topic. Like I said, we will have copies of the book and the reading list. If you would, let's put our hands together and just thank Mike for coming.